Hello, how are you doing?
Fine.
Welcome to the B120 class, our new class. Greetings to all other branches, my students in other branches and my colleagues in other branches as well. Today, inshallah, we are continuing on book one. And I'd like to ask you about the last class. What did we cover last class? Do you remember?
Yes, SWOT analysis.
SWOT analysis?
External environment.
External environment, okay. Go ahead,
steep
very
level.
Good.
Steep model.
Steep model, excellent. Okay. This was in session, which session? Session two. Session two of book one. Okay. What about session one?
We cannot define the business.
How to define a business, excellent. Different types of businesses, right? Based on different criteria, okay? All right, you need to study. You need to study. When you go home, you need to study. You should, okay? All right. So today, inshallah, we are continuing on our the first book, book one. Today, we will cover sessions 3, 4, and 5. 3, 4, and 5. Okay? Session 3 is about business structure. Business structure. As we agreed before starting to explain what to study in the sessions, we should read the objectives. We should know about the aims of this session, right? Okay, to make sure that we're on the right track in studying, in discussing, and in any other time of interaction concerning this session, okay? So, the aims and objectives of session three, communicate the advantages and disadvantages of structuring a business. Structuring a business. Communicate the advantages and disadvantages, okay, of structuring a business. Which means that this is an issue that we need to know about. Do we have only advantages? Do we have only disadvantages of structuring a business? Okay? Should we have a structure? This is a very important thing, okay? The second aim is to explain the differences between formal and informal business structure. Formal and informal. So here we are talking about two types of structures, okay? All right. Familiarize you with some of the main types of business structures. Main types. Finally, consider some of the variables that can be explored to identify structures within business. Okay. These are the aims of session three. Let's start. When I say a structure, what comes to your mind?
Rules.
Okay, what else?
Basis.
Basis or basics? I didn't hear you. Basis, a base, to have a base for something? Okay, what else? A structure. A structure. Okay. So it's a base for something. Okay. And you say that it might organize some rules. All right. So do you think that it might have something to do with designing a business?
Yes.
In a specific way? Okay. But the word design here is not the typical word we said actually. Because you can design the business in different ways. Structure is more specific. Is more specific. Related to something related to the identity of the company. Something related to allocating responsibilities inside an organization. Okay? So let's see. A structure gives a business an identity and provides a framework for the allocation of roles and responsibilities. Roles and responsibilities. Okay? All businesses should have a structure. Did you get anything from what I said now? Started to imagine what we mean by a structure or not yet?
The location of the business?
Responsibilities.
Okay.
Inside an organization. Okay. This means that the structure will enable everybody in an organization to know his role, right? Okay. To know his responsibilities, right? Okay. All right. Let's see. And when we talk about structure, we should talk about what's called organizational chart. The organizational chart. Organizational chart is a graphical presentation of the business structure. Graphical presentation of a business structure. Okay. Let's see here. We have here company XYZ. Here we have the president of the company. Okay? Here we have assistant president. In the northern region. And here we have assistant president in the southern region. What is this? This is an organizational chart, part of an organizational chart. It's a part, just part. Starts with the president, and what comes when you see this chart? Can you interpret it? What do you understand from this chart? Go ahead.
There is a head and under.
Excellent. There is a head who is the president. Go ahead.
And there is assistant under the president.
And we have assistant
under the president.
How many assistants?
Two.
Two. One for the northern region and the other for the southern region. Which means that we have two assistants under the president. Okay. Can you tell me about the situation of power here? The state of power? Who is the most powerful in this company? How did you know that?
Because he's on top.
He is on the top.
Yeah. Huh?
And he has two assistants. Excellent, okay.
He owns the business.
He might not be owning the business, because in business we need to differentiate between two things. Between the owner and the management. Okay? So we have very small businesses, the owner most probably is the manager of the business, if he has the experience and the necessary qualifications. Okay? But in larger companies, usually there is a difference between the owner and the management. The owner owns the place and benefits out of the profit. Okay? On the other hand, management are hired to manage the organization, okay, because they have the experience, they have the qualification, and so on. Alright? So this person might be just top management. Okay? He is not the owner, not necessarily to be the owner in this case. Alright? Alright. Okay, so here we have this organizational chart. Throughout this organizational chart, you were able to say that the most powerful person is this president, right, in an organization, or the position. This is the most powerful position, okay? And which means that this line indicates the authority and power line, right? Agree? The authority and power. Okay. And this means that this line indicates that the president can delegate some authorities to his assistant or her assistants. Right? Okay. What about this line, the horizontal one? Indicates what? Go ahead, think about it. Come on. Two assistants. They are on the same level, same managerial level, right? And this line indicates that that there must be coordination between these two assistants, some way or another, right? Last time we said that part of one of our the business characteristics is businesses should coordinate. You remember that? You remember? Okay. So this reflects the coordination between the two assistants and reflects that you're at the same managerial level. Okay? With this hierarchy. Alright? Good? Alright, now you have a better understanding of what we mean by a business structure and organizational chart? Answer me.
Yes.
Okay. If you do not understand, let me know. Okay, fine? Fine? Okay, let's go through this slide. Most businesses have some sort of organizational chart. Okay, which provides clues about the structure of the business. The chart will do the following. The chart will do the following. Show the relationships between different individuals and departments. The relationships between different individuals and departments, right? Okay. Provide an outline of the official decision-making process. An outline of the official decision-making process. Who should make the decision here?
President.
The president. And if he delegates authority to one of his assistants, the assistants can make decisions in particular, concerning particular transactions and activities, right?
Yes.
Okay, so the shape of the chart can tell us how, can tell us much about the way in which the business works. How? The shape of the chart can tell us about how the business works. Huh? Agree?
Yeah.
Okay. Because now we know that the
assistant,
autonomous, because this is only just part of the chart, okay? And the taller charts means that we have different levels of power. Taller charts. Taller and thinner charts means that we have different levels and many levels of power, right? In the hierarchy. Okay. The flatter charts reflect what? Reflect that we don't have a lot of power and authority levels, right? It's flat. It's flat. All right. Okay. So we have, we agree that in any business we need to have a structure because we need to know who is responsible for making decisions, we need to know who has the power, the authority, who can delegate authorities, with whom you can communicate in an organization, and so on. All these things are important. So you agree that structure is an important thing in an organization?
Yes.
Okay. Do you agree that the chart is a very good tool in understanding how business works? Okay, very good. All right, so do you think that all businesses will have the same type of structure?
No.
No.
Why not?
It's different business.
Different businesses should have different types of structure. Why? Go ahead.
Because it's different. There's food business, there's shop business.
Different industries?
Yeah.
Different industries that serve different markets, right?
Okay.
And what else, I'm sorry?
Needs and wants of the company.
Different needs and wants that they, to the specific segment that they target, which are right. Different sizes, right? Different nature, some of them are for profit, some of them are not for profit, right? Okay. some of them are public, some of them are private, right? Okay. Some of them are small, others are medium, some are joint or large, right? And so on. So the structure should differ from one business to another. Okay. This means here you can structure the business using various ways. You can structure it by function, by product or service, or by geography. How to do that? By function, by product, or by geography? Okay, back to this chart. Can you tell me which type of structures is this?
Function.
Function. Why did you say that?
Because it's explaining who controls the business and
go ahead.
And assistants, they take an order from the president.
Okay, so you think that it's by function because the structure here or the chart told you who manages who, right? Okay.
Geography.
What's your name?
Dawood.
Dawood. Yeah. Huh. Geography. Why?
Because there's north region and south region.
North region and south region. So here, all the structures will tell you about the lines of power and authority, regardless of the time. But here, what we mean, when you say that we have president and we have two assistants, one for the northern region and the other for the southern region. So this is by territory, right? By geography, by location.
Place.
Okay? So assume you have a company here in Egypt, in Cairo, okay? And they have different branches in Delta, in Upper Egypt, and so on. Okay? And they structure the company based on this. Assistant president for Delta Ethiopia or Egypt. Assistant president for Upper Egypt, and so on. In Egypt and other Arab countries. Assistant president in KSA. Assistant president in Lebanon. Assistant president, and so on. Okay? This means that you structure by geography. You structure by
geography.
Okay. All right. So how to structure by function or by product? Let's start by function. Okay? All right. So this assistant president has here manufacturing department, and here marketing, and finally finance.
This is the function.
This is when you structure by function. Marketing function, accounting and finance function, production. Or operations. What do you think? Okay, this is by function. Now you know the difference between them? Okay, all right. And here, manufacturing, we have here, for example, this is a furniture company, okay? So we have beds, we have tables, and so on.
Product.
This is by product. Excellent.
Okay.
Now you know the difference. So in the same organizational chart, you might have different types of structures, right? We started this structure by geography. And then they continued structuring the business by function and by product. You understand the difference? And when you structure by product, you would like to focus on the resources you have, and you allocate for a specific product. And you want to know how much profits you get out of this product. This is your focus point. Okay? So when you use any of the types, you have your own reasons. Why did I structure my business based on this? Okay? Malcolm. What's wrong? Okay, fine. What's your name?
Haya.
Haya, fine? Why don't you answer? You know that I have flu today? I'm talking. Do you have flu? First time? Okay, yeah. Okay. What's your name?
Omnaya.
Okay. You are okay? Ahmed?
Say,
you're okay? You understand? Okay. Ali? Mayor? Okay, fine. Alright, so answer me. Alright? Every time you don't answer me, I will go back and ask you about your names and ask you if you don't understand. Answer me and try to communicate, alright? Okay. So now you know what we mean by business structure, right? You know what we mean by organizational chart, right? You know that we have different types of business structures. Okay, and different businesses follow different types or apply different types of structures because they have some focus point that they would like to concentrate on. Okay, all right. So, and here we have a very important question. Do you think that any business, you can run any of the businesses without having a structure? Why not?
It's the base.
It's the base, as Ahmed said. It's the base. Imagine the problems, try to imagine with me, the problems that we will encounter if we have a structureless business.
High costs.
High costs?
And low profit.
Low profit. Why? Why? You don't know? But you feel that there is something wrong in the business because it doesn't have a structure, right? And accordingly, this thing will affect your revenues and expenses, profits and losses, right? Okay, I agree with you because you feel that there is something wrong, but you don't know how it goes. Okay, huh? Problems. What does the structure do?
Organizes
the relationships between the power lines, authority, decision making, right?
Yes.
If you do not yet save, have a structure in a business. If you do not have a structure in a business, do you think that you will be able to know who is responsible for what?
Everybody will take decisions.
Everybody will take decisions. Excellent. Everybody will take decisions. Right? Everybody will be responsible for anything. And you can say that I'm not responsible for this thing, although it's yours. Right? What else? Think about it. Huh? Convinced? Have the problems of trying to run a structureless business. Try to run a structureless business. It wouldn't be clear who was and who was not part of the business. Here the structure tells me who is part of the business, who is not part of the business, right? Okay. Here in this case it wouldn't be clear who is part of the business, who is not part of the business. Okay? There won't be no way of getting objectives agreed and hence of measuring success. How to agree on objectives? Whose responsibility is this? To set objectives and agree upon objectives, approve them and start implementation and so on.
To make orders also.
Yes, and to follow up on all these things. Who should be responsible for that? We don't have a structure. How to set objectives and agree on objectives without having a structure? You imagine this? Okay, there won't be no agreed way of making decisions. Who should make this type of decisions? Huh? Can you tell me without having a structure?
No.
All right. All decisions will be open for reconsideration whenever anyone was unhappy with them. So I made a decision. We don't have a structure. I made a decision, and you are not happy with this decision. So you come tomorrow and say, no, I'm changing this decision. I'm making a new, a newer decision. Okay? Because I can't tell you this is my responsibility. This is my authority to make this decision. It's not yours. Why? Because I don't have a structure. Right? Okay. It wouldn't be clear who should do what work. Who should do what? It wouldn't be clear, right? Because the structure allocates responsibilities, duties, authorities, and everything. All right. Individuals and other bodies in the external environment wouldn't know whom to contact. We have a customer. The customer has a complaint. And he calls, I have a complaint. Okay, it's not my responsibility. Okay, it's Haya's responsibility. Haya, no, it's not my responsibility, it's Sage's responsibility. Okay, and then the customer will be lost. The same for suppliers or any other body, any other entity. The supplier delivered products, okay, raw materials, and he would like to take the money. Okay, okay, who should sign the documents?
Anyone.
Anyone can sign. Yes, anyone can sign. No one. It depends. Okay? So, for this reason, we say that it's impossible to have a structureless business. It's impossible to have a structureless business. Impossible. No way. Okay? But you can have some businesses that are more flexible in its structure. More flexible structures than in other businesses.
Just like McDonald's.
Like McDonald's. Why do you think that they have flexible structure?
Because the manager or the could take an order from the person.
They take, I'm sorry, I can't hear you. Repeat again. The manager?
The manager could take the order.
Can take the order from the president? Okay, from the president of McDonald's?
No. Huh? I mean the client.
That?
Client.
The client. Okay. Actually, in order to decide if McDonald's has a flexible structure, we need to study the structure of McDonald's.
Each branch has a manager.
Each branch has a manager. Yeah. Excellent. Huh. And this means what?
Organized.
Oh, okay. Now, when they decide, you have to ask yourself some questions in this case. This is a very good activity, by the way. Okay? Ask yourself and go and search. How do the managers in branches make decisions? Do you have the authority delegated to them to order whatever they would like to manage the branch? Which authorities do they have? Okay? Which level of power? All right? Okay? So go and search. Search and study the structure of McDonald's and tell me, why do you think that it's more flexible than other organizations? Okay? All right? Most probably because it is decentralized, it has decentralized operations, and this is one of the main reasons, but I'd like you to go and search. Okay? All right. So here, now we all agree that structures are very important. Okay. Structures have advantages, four main advantages when we talk about structures. And when I ask you why they are important, you can tell me structures have four main advantages. What are they? The first advantage is enabling participation. Enabling participation. The structure of any business will determine how all the relevant sections and parties join in its activities and influence its decisions. Right or wrong? It allocates responsibilities, right? It tells every department, you are responsible for this part, for this task, right? You can make decisions about this issue, but not about the other one, okay? You need to coordinate to do 1, 2, 3. So it enables participation. Everybody will be participating in doing work. Okay? This is the first advantage. The second advantage is providing a framework for the allocation of responsibilities and authority. framework of the allocation of responsibilities and authorities. We agreed on that from the very beginning. So everybody knows his tasks, his role, his responsibilities, and authorities, right? All right, establishing an identity for the business. When we say an identity, this is mainly concerned with helping external parties, bodies or entities, to communicate with the company. When they need anything, a customer has a complaint, a supplier has something, a transaction with us, whatever, whoever would like to communicate the company will know with whom he should communicate exactly. The structure will enable them to do that. So when we talk about identity, this is what we mean here, okay? All right, the last one, continuity and the change. Okay, now we are in an ever-changing environment, right? Okay, so you expect to have different changes because of the instability in different forces, right? Okay, and we studied that in the external environment. Agree? All right. So, if you don't have a structure, can you imagine how to cope with these changes? People will start to reinvent the wheel. Every time they have a change, they don't have a base to rely on in making decisions concerning this change. Okay? Which means that having a structure will enable the company to continue on the right track within the in the light of having these changes. Okay? Regardless of all changes. You have a structure that will tell you we had an experience, a similar experience previously. Okay? We made this decision. This department is responsible for 1, 2, 3. Okay, and they can handle such problems and so on. Otherwise, whenever you have a change in the external environment, you will start a new system, you will start doing things differently, okay? Sometimes you have to do things differently to cope with the changes and to react, but at the end, you don't have to reinvent the wheel, okay? All right, so these are about the advantages of business structure. Any questions? Sure? Okay. And here we have to differentiate between two types of structures. The formal structure and the informal structure. What's the difference? When I say the word formal, what comes to your mind? Formal.
Organized.
Mm-hmm. Huh? Something formal, which will mean? I sent him a formal letter.
Yeah.
Right? Formal. How to prove that this was formal? To make something formal, how to do it? You need to have what?
Structure. Basis.
You need to write it. Right? You need to have a document, right? Okay? So when we talk about the formal structure is a well-agreed upon explanation of the different parts of the business and the different jobs within it. Different parts of the business and different jobs within it. And usually the formal structure is written. It is written. Structure is written and it has an organizational chart, as we saw. Okay? This way, you have it formally. Okay? This way, you can say that those people are responsible for this and can make such decisions. This is the only way. All right. The second type is the informal structure. The informal structure. The informal, when I say informal, do you think that it's written?
Yes.
Written? Informal? Huh? Go ahead. Why do you think that the informal should be written?
Go ahead.
You don't know what? You don't want, you think that it should be written, but you don't know why?
Yes.
Or you think that it shouldn't be written?
Informal structure should be written.
Should be, the format should be written, the informal should be written as well? This is what you think, okay. No problem. Why do you think so? This is what I'm asking.
There's difference between formal and informal.
Right.
The structure of the document, for example.
We have a document, the formal should be documented, should be written.
Yes.
Okay, the informal. Okay. Well, I think, I'm not positive, but I think that you think anything related to structure should be written. This is what you think?
Yes.
Okay. But let me tell you something here. All what you have to write should be written in the formal structure, in the formal aspect. Anything that you think should be written, write it in the formal structure. Okay? But the informal structure is unlikely to be written. It's unlikely to be written. Why? Because it deals with the chemistry exists between different members in the organization. What do we mean by that chemistry? It's about feelings, emotional aspects. It deals with respect, with motivation. Do you think, okay, this is the president, right? Here, this is the president, right? Okay. Do you think that assistants should respect the president or not?
Yes.
Do you think that all assistants respect their presidents?
No.
Unfortunately, no, because sometimes, they have some negative practices, they have their own opinion, okay? Regardless of the reason, but not all assistants respect their president, right? Okay, do you think that president should motivate assistants and other employees? Okay, do you think that all presidents motivate assistants and their employees? Oh, no. So, for this reason we say the informal structure is unlikely to be written because it's very difficult to write that the president should motivate employees and the assistant should respect the president. Okay? And it might not be the case because it's related to the emotional aspect. You got that? Okay. So, the informal structure is less likely to be written down on the organizational chart. It is about the relationships between individuals, and it can be complicated because of the human emotional element involved. Human emotional element involved. Okay? Right? All right. So, do you have any questions about structure?
What is the disadvantage of the structure?
What are the disadvantages of structure? You are right, a very good point. Tell me.
I don't know, I'm asking.
You don't know, you are asking. Anybody can help me in answering this question? Anybody can help me? Safe? Can you help me in answering his question? Listen and concentrate. Okay, so Mayor said that you told us about the advantages of having business structure, but you did not tell us about the disadvantages of having business structure. What are the disadvantages?
Anybody can take a decision.
You are close to the answer. Like you said that.
I had to solve them one.
If we have a structure, or if we don't have. He asks if we have a structure. When we have a structure, what are the disadvantages of having a structure? Disadvantages, not advantages. Disadvantages of having a business structure. What do you think? Imagine. Try to imagine. If the structure is inflexible, along a chain of command, Mayor, along a chain of command, you know what I mean?
No.
Okay, less flexible structures. This is the disadvantage of having structures. we have this disadvantage when we have less flexible business structures. When we have a less flexible business structure, this means that power and authority is concentrated at the top of the pyramid. Here. You can't make decisions. The president does not delegate authority as much as he should or she should do. Okay? And how can this affect? Which means that this is a long chain of command. When the president would like one of the tasks to be done, he asks the assistant asks the manager, the production manager department, the manager of the production department, and then and so on until they reach the employee. For example, this is a very long chain of command, right? When the decision making is concentrated at this level, what do you think about that? Do you think that we can be flexible in making our decisions, and we can make use of the time constraints? Time constraint, because sometimes you need to make a decision immediately, right? As a manager in one of the locations, right? You need to build experience of people working in different branches, right? How to gain the experience without experiencing or without practicing making decisions? If all decisions are focused at the top level.
With authority to the assistant.
Yes, you should delegate authority for you are one. For this reason, we have some flexible structures and some inflexible structures. This is the what we say. The flexible structures are okay, but the less flexible structures can tell us about the disadvantages of some structures. Okay? You got that? All right. So now we are done with session three. Business structure, organizational charts, advantages of business structure, different types of business structure, formal and informal structures. Fine? Okay. All right. Here we have session four. Session four is about business culture. It's about business culture. When I say culture, what comes to your mind?
Country.
Country? Okay, because usually cultures are related to countries.
Religion also.
Religion? Okay.
People?
Places.
Places.
Places, you mean countries? Yeah. Or places inside one, the same country?
Yeah.
Okay. What else? Who else? What comes to your mind when you hear the word culture?
Critical thinking.
Critical thinking. Why?
مثلا المنطقة دي معروفة مثلا باللي هو تطلع أفكار جديدة وناجحة مثلا بلد دي مثلا بتطلع أفكار جديدة وناجحة
ثقافة ثقافة culture is ثقافة in Arabic.
ماشي.
Okay. So you say that it has something to do with the activities or some famous products in different countries?
لا مقصود يعني مثلا كل بلد عندها مثلا أفكار مثلا مبنية على حاجات فبتطلع مثلا أفكار جديدة. كده.
Okay, it's not your decision. Okay, so you think that every country has its own traditions, for example? Okay, and these traditions will lead them to come up with some behaviors and ideas that are that comply with these traditions?
تمشي مثلا مع العادات بتاعتنا مثلا وتمشي بره برضه.
Okay, so you mean that each country has its own traditions, right? And some traditions are common between different countries. Some others are not, right? Is what you mean?
مش بالظبط بس هو
Okay, tell me, give me an example to understand you.
هو مفيش example.
Okay, let's see. Now we'll talk about culture and we'll see if this matches what you have in your mind or not, okay? So when we say culture, as Dawood said, he remembers countries, he remembers religion, he remembers people, and all these things, and so on. Okay? Let's see. First of all, let's start with the aims and objectives of this session. Okay. Illustrate how the metaphor of culture can help us to understand more about the less obvious aspects of a business. Less obvious means unclear aspects of a business. Demonstrate how the work of Hofstede on national cultures was used to develop the idea of organizational culture. Okay, so we have two types of cultures. This is what we should understand from this point. National and organizational. What is the difference between them? We'll know now. Provide some definitions and explanation of the culture concept in business context. And finally, consider some of the factors influencing or shaping culture. All right. So let's take an example. Now, here in Egypt, we have some traditions, right? Okay. These are common to all Egyptians, right? Traditions and values. Values, common values, right? And common values means common beliefs, right? Okay, common beliefs means what? Means we'll, when we are in a specific situation, we will behave in similar manners, although we are different people. Why? Because we belong to the same culture, the Egyptian culture. Okay? Okay, a wider perspective. Our people in the Arab world, we have common traditions, common views, common beliefs, common values, which will lead us to what? To behave, to have a specific norm that will lead us to behave in a specific manner towards different situations. Right? Why? Because we belong to the same culture. We belong to the same culture. So the culture usually comes from different factors. Different factors, such as religion. This is one of the factors constituting culture. Okay, so the example that I gave you, is about the national culture. When we talk about Egypt, when we talk about the Arab world, this is the national culture, not the organizational one, right? Okay. And do you think that organizations have their own cultures? They do?
Yeah.
Okay. So why do you think so?
Every country has their own.
Every country. I'm talking about organizations.
Okay.
National culture. Okay. And as we said before, all organizations have values, views. They have vision, as I told you. They have mission. They have some views and values concerning achieving the purpose of the business, right? Which is very similar to the traditions in any country. Accordingly, they behave in the employees working in the same organization behave in similar manners, right? Towards different situations. Because we all pursue the same goals. We all try to achieve the organizational goals, right? Okay, so this is just an intro. Let's start element by element to get a better understanding of what we mean the national culture first and then the organizational culture. One of the most important elements in national culture is Hofstede five dimensions. Hofstede, this man, analyzed national cultures, the culture in different countries, based on five factors. Okay, he started by four in 1980, and in 1991, he added the last one, the fifth one. Okay, so when he suggested that if you would like to analyze a culture, the culture of any country, analyze this culture in the light of these five elements. In the light of these five elements. The first element is power distance. This is the first dimension, power distance. The second is individualism, collectivism. Masculinity, femininity. Uncertainty, avoidance, and confusion, dynamism. What do you mean by that? Let's take them one by one. Okay. All right. The first one is the power distance. The power distance. The power distance is the extent to which less powerful members within a country expect and accept that power is distributed unequally. Less powerful members in a country expect and accept the unequal distribution of power. Like where? You understand the point? In some countries, we have unequal allocation of power between the members of the society, right? Some people got power, some others did not get this power, or do not get this power, right? Okay, like where? Like in different developing countries, right? We have some people dominate other people. Some people got power over others, right? Do you think that everybody in Egypt has the same level of power? Right? So this is what we mean by power distance. This is what we mean by power distance. Okay, so the extent or the degree to which people, less powerful people, can expect and accept the unequal distribution of power. The unequal, you expect this and you accept it. We call this high power distance society. If you are like that, if people in a country, one of the countries, are like that, we call this country high power distant country. Why? Because there is unequal distribution of power inside this country, okay? People there, the less powerful people, expect to have unequal distribution of power and accept it. They do not object, they do not say no. All right? Okay. How can this affect our businesses? Is this a culture class or business class? It's a business class. So anything you study should be related to business, right? Okay. So when we say some countries are high power distant, others are low power distant. Low means that people there, we have equal, most probably we have equal distribution of power. And even if we don't have this equal distribution of power, people there do not expect and they do not accept the unequal distribution of power, okay? Okay, this is the low power distant countries. So what Hofstede said that national cultures affect the organizational cultures. So the organization operating in one of the high power distant countries will be affected by this national culture. How? So you can't expect to have unequal distribution of power in this organization. You can't expect that the president can hire his relatives, for example. You can't expect that some people can be demoted instead of being promoted, and they will not complain. Yeah. Huh?
Because they accept it.
Yes. So before traveling to any of the countries to work there, try to understand the national culture, because the national culture will enable you to understand the organizational culture of the company that you work in. Because usually it is affected by the national culture. Okay? This is about the first dimension. The first dimension. Okay. Any questions about the power distance? Power distance? No? Okay. The second dimension is individualism, collectivism. What do you mean by that? Some societies are very individualistic. People care about themselves and their families, and that's it. You don't care about anybody else. Okay? All right. On the other hand, some countries are collectivistic. People there care about themselves, their families, and others. Okay? All right. So how can this affect, this is part of the national culture, all right? How can this affect our organizational culture? How can this be reflected on the organization, on the practices in an organization?
Everybody will care about themselves, not the organization.
Not the organization and not their colleagues, right? Excellent. What else? Hiring people based on hiring and firing contracts. What do you think about that? Hiring and firing. Individualistic community or collectivistic community? Individualistic community. Why? Because they care about themselves and their family. They don't care about anybody else, right? So you can't expect to have hiring and firing contracts in such companies, in companies operating in such societies, right? Okay. On the other hand, for collectivistic societies, like Indonesia, for example, people there care about themselves, their families, and others. Okay. So when they offer contracts to businesses, businesses are affected by the organizational culture, the business is affected by the national culture, okay? So, businesses will offer people long-term contracts. This is an example, okay? Long-term contracts. And even if those people are not very successful in their positions, they try to offer them another chance by training them to fit them in any other department and so on. Why? Because this is part of the national culture. They care about themselves, their families, and others. Okay? So this is reflected on the organizational culture there. Okay? So it's better to work in Indonesia rather than working in Canada or Australia. Okay? All right. Masculinity, femininity. This refers to the degree to which gender roles are distinct and adhered to within the society. In high femininity societies, social gender roles overlap. Okay. All right, so when I say I'm looking for a driver for a truck in Egypt, male or female?
Male, male of course.
In Arab world, male or female?
Male.
Male. Okay. In Europe, some countries?
Both.
Both. Whoever is more qualified can take it. Right? Whoever is more qualified can take it. Okay. So this is what we mean here. Femininity, masculinity, yes. Masculinity, when the society is masculine, they differentiate between the role of male and female. So Egypt is a masculine community or society. And the other Arab countries, okay? All right. In Europe, some countries are masculine, some others are feminine. It depends, okay? All right, so how can this be reflected on the organizational culture when you, for example, as an example, when you have a job vacancy, if it is a masculine society and you have some specific roles for male, some other roles for female. Who should be promoted to be assistant president? A lady or man?
Degree. It depends.
It depends. It depends. Depends on society, the organizational culture in an organization and so on. Right? Okay. So now you know the difference between the masculine societies or masculine national cultures, feminine national cultures, and how they affect the organizational cultures in the countries, in different countries of these different types. Okay? Okay? Any questions? Okay. The fourth dimension, uncertainty avoidance. Uncertainty avoidance. Okay. Some people are risk takers. Some others are risk averse. You don't want to take risk. You don't want to take risk. And actually, this is part of the national culture. Part of the national culture. For example, in European countries and the states, people are risk avoidance.
So they
national, the culture is riskable, and even in Egypt. In Asian countries, people there believe in innovation, and they care about coming up with new ideas. Like in Singapore, for example, coming up with new ideas rather than sticking to just the traditional way of thinking without making any new thing. They don't want to do that. They care about having you come up with new ideas. Of course, they don't want to lose. But if they lost just to come up with a new idea, they don't mind. Because they know that without having the courage to try and to be innovative, you'll never be able to survive forever. You will never be able to survive. This is what you mean? Okay, excellent. Okay, finally we know what you mean. Okay.
No risk, no fun.
No risk, no fun. Okay. So this is another part. How can this reflect upon the organizational culture in different countries? The countries in which people are risk averse. Management style, risk averse. We don't want to take risks. They are traditional. They don't allocate a lot of resources for innovation, right? All right, and they do not tolerate failure. All right, which means that the environment in such countries might be very discouraging to innovation. On the other hand, for countries in which people are risk takers, and that part of the national culture is not to avoid the uncertainty, okay? This means that management style there will be very friendly to innovative ideas, right? They will ask people to give recommendations, right? Give new ideas, like in Japan, for example, right? Most of the new products come from labor or workers' ideas. Workers' new ideas. They encourage everybody to participate, to contribute with a new idea. Okay? So, this is the uncertainty avoidance. What about Confucian dynamism? This refers to the extent to which long-termism and short-termism appear to be the dominant approach. Okay? Long-term stresses perseverance. Short term involves greater emphasis on quick results. The long term stresses perseverance. Be patient. Wait for the results. Plan well. You might take longer time achieving your goals, but you will survive forever or for a longer time. Okay? But those who look for the short term profits, Yasif. Those who look for short-term profits, or short-term believe in short-term termism, of course they will do what? Yes, they might not fail. They look for the short-term, but they might not survive and having a long-term brand name and so on. Okay, like in the States. In the States, they look for short-term profits. Okay? In Japan, they look for long-term success and survival. Okay. Do you have any questions concerning Hofstede's five dimensions? All right. So, Saif, what are the Hofstede's five dimensions? Loudly.
Power distance. And individualism and collectivism.
Good.
Masculinity and femininity.
Good.
Uncertainty avoidance.
Good.
Confusion. Dynamism.
All right. So this is about the national culture. Do you have any questions concerning national culture? Do you think that what Hofstede proposed is valid? What do you think? Answer me loudly, please. What do you think?
No.
Yes. Or no?
Yes.
About Hofstede's five dimensions. Do you think that this is valid?
Yes.
You think that you can make use of this information?
Yes.
Okay. In the light of globalization, in the light of globalization, starting new businesses abroad, expanding your activities. Now you are starting a subsidiary or a branch in another country. Do you think that it is important for you to understand the national culture there before starting your business? Huh? What do you think? Do you think that Hofstede's five dimension will help you in conducting this analysis? Okay, very good. Excellent. Now, we should start with the organizational culture. With the organizational culture. Okay, what do you mean by organizational culture? Now, we all agree that we know that we have national culture and organizational culture. And the national impacts on the organization. Okay, all right. So, the culture, when we talk about the organizational culture, it's a pattern of beliefs and expectations shared by organizational members. Beliefs and expectations shared by the organizational members. Why? Why share? Remember, usually, we have some views, common views and values about the purpose of the business. We pursue the same goals, right? Remember, this company is not just a company. It plays the role of a country in our life as employees, okay? All right, so they share, it's a pattern of beliefs and expectations shared by organizational members. These beliefs and expectations produce norms, beliefs and expectations produce norms that powerfully shape the behavior of individuals. So you have beliefs, you have expectations, this will shape a norm, this norm will shape your behavior. Shape your behavior? Okay. So, the behavior of, it will shape the behavior of individuals and groups within the organization. We have a customer complaint. Okay? The customer coming back with the product. He's very hungry. It's not working. I have problems with this unit. Return it back. I'd like to return it back. Okay. If the culture there is positive, the business culture is positive, okay, and people believe in customer satisfaction, what will they do? They will do everything. They will try to satisfy the customer, welcome him, listening to him, right? Trying to handle his problems, returning the product back to him if he is not satisfied at all at the end, right or not? Okay? On the other hand, if it is a negative culture, some negative cultures are there. No returns, right? Sometimes no returns. They don't allow returning the product back, okay? They care about making sales and that's it. So they sell the product to you and they don't follow up if you are satisfied or not satisfied as a customer and so on. Okay? So this is part of the organizational culture. So because we all have common beliefs, common expectations, so we have common norm. This norm led everybody in the organization to handle the customer complaint this way, to behave this way. You got that? This is what we mean by organizational culture. Okay? All right? All right. So the organizational culture has to be learned by newcomers. What do we mean by newcomers here? What do we mean by newcomers? In a newcomer in an organization? A new?
Employees
or what? Employees. A new employee. Excellent. Okay. So we need to tell them about our culture in an organization. How to do that? How to do that? Why, this is a newcomer. He doesn't understand how it goes, how it works, right? Should he satisfy the customer or not? Should he return the product back? Should he listen to them? How to deal with angry customers? How to deal with satisfied customers? What to do, right? How to be honest? All these things are related to our culture. in the organization. So you have to transfer the organizational culture to the newcomers through what we call socialization process. Socialization is used to describe how new employees learn the less obvious rules within the organization. So this socialization might take 6 months.
Training
period. In order to make him familiar and make the newcomer familiar with the organizational culture. And we will take this in detail in book 2. Book 2, inshallah. Okay? So this is about the organizational culture. All right. So here, Trice and Pair in 1984 suggested that businesses has two types of symbols. And these symbols are related to the organizational culture. The high-level symbols, which are related to the shape of the buildings, the logos, how the building looks like, how the logo looks like. This is affected by the culture. For example, the buildings at the campus of AOU, do you think that it's the same as any of the American or British universities abroad? It's different. Why?
It's a different culture.
Because of the different culture. Okay? Because of the different culture. And here, the national culture is very obvious in this case. What about to get a better focus on the organizational culture? AOU, okay, campus, and the American University in Cairo. Both of them are located in Egypt. Similar buildings? Or different buildings? Why?
Because
we have different organizational culture. Different organizational culture. You got that? So this is what they mean by the high-level symbols. And then the low-level symbols. Low-level symbols include the practices, the communications, physical forms, and common language. Let's take them one by one. Practices. Huh. In our company, we are used to celebrate birthday of our employees. Conduct birthday parties. We usually celebrate after successful projects. These are practices. This is one of the companies. Another company, no, we do not do that. We don't have such practices. Okay. The first company has its own organizational culture that led it to conduct these practices. Okay? All right. So this is about practice. So you can understand and the organizational culture is reflected in the practices of the organization. Okay? It is also reflected in the communications. How the company communicate with others through different slogans. Ritual. Yeah. Yes, and the language would be the last factor. Through different stories, myths, and slogans circulated. What do you mean by that? How did we start our business? Some companies usually advertise this. How did we start our business? How did we start our business? Okay. What about the successful stories do we have? We have, okay? Usually, when they celebrate 10 years after starting the business, they talk about how they started the business. They communicate these stories with people. All right? Okay, and so on. Physical forms, location, open plan, individual offices, types of eating areas, the physical forms inside the organization itself is affected by the organizational culture. Do we have eating areas? And how do they look like? Have you ever visited any of the companies? Have you ever visited any of the companies? No. Who visited any of the companies?
Organizations.
You visited some? Okay. Do you think? Have you ever seen an eating area in any of the companies that you visited?
Yeah.
Okay, in all of them or some of them only?
Some of
all of them
yeah.
got
yeah.
eating hearing. Are they similar?
No.
Why? What's the difference?
The people are different. The food for the people is different.
The food, but the place. I'm talking about the place.
Place? No, not different.
So not different?
No.
Almost the same?
But the same, but not big difference also, no?
Not big difference?
Yeah.
Okay. Have you ever been to a Chinese restaurant?
Yes.
Okay. And compare this Chinese restaurant to McDonald's, to KFC. How do you feel?
Yeah, it's different.
Different to what? The area which you eat, the tables, how they organize the place, right?
Yeah.
How they render the service to you,
yeah.
right? Of course, in addition to the type of food, I'm not talking about food now, I'm talking about the physical forms, in specific, okay? Which means that different cultures, different organizational cultures is reflected on the physical forms. And what about the common language? Common language. Each institution or each organization has its own language. For example, AOU. Huh. Do we have our own language or not? B120. When you go to any of the universities and tell them about B120, they will never understand anything, right? Because this is our citizenship language here in AOU, right? B120. TMA. MTA. Right? T205. T306. B202. B203. B300. B301. What's this? When you go to any place and tell people, talk to people this way, they will never understand you. Why? Why? Because, yes, this is part of our organizational culture here in AOU, right? The language that we use, the common language. But at the same time, we all understand each other. What? Okay, this is because of the common language derived from our culture, organizational culture in AOU. Okay, and finally here we have the factors influencing organizational culture. Some factors influence the organizational culture in any organization. There are 12 factors. And when we will read them now, we go through them, I'd like you to tell me if you are convinced if these factors really affect our organizational culture or not. Okay, let's see. The influence of dominant leader, the founder of the organization, vision, management style, personality. Do you think that the founder or the dominant leader, personality, influenced the culture of the place?
Yes.
I believe so. What do you think? Yes, sure. Okay. The history and tradition of business, how things have always been done.
Yes.
This is very important. How we used to conduct our business.
The history of the company.
The history of the company. You are right. The type of technology used. Huh? The industry or sector the business is in, and the level of competition. Think about it. Some people will not. You don't understand it. That the industry or sector, like, is this a service sector company? Is it a manufacturing company? Is it a restaurant? Is it a consultancy? Is it, you know, to which sector it belongs? This will affect the culture of the company. Okay, the customers of the business, who they are and what they expect. The customers. Affect our organizational culture? Okay, company expectations. The types of information and control systems used. Information and control system. How it looks like in our organization. Does this affect the culture?
Yes.
You think so? Okay. Policies and regulations. Of course, they affect the culture. The reward system and the measurement of performance. Reward system. Does this affect the culture?
Reward.
Well, each of these factors are proposed as be affecting the organizational culture. Some of them, from my own point of view, some of them affect the organizational culture. Some others do not affect the organizational culture. It depends. It depends on what you think and how you interpret each, the effect of each of the factors. Okay? So take this as an activity and try to work on when you go home. Read them and tell me, why do you think next time in our activity hour, tell me why? Why do you think that these factors affect the organizational culture? Or why don't you think so? Okay? You got that? So this is the activity you should go through them, try to understand each one, and try to think of the effect of each one on different business cultures, and tell me which ones affect the business culture and which ones do not affect from your own point of view. Okay? Okay. All right. So any questions about business culture? Questions? So what did we cover in this session? Huh?
National culture.
Organizational culture. Excellent. Huh? What else? The dimensions? Hofstede. Hofstede's five dimensions. Okay.
Different types of structure.
Different types of structure. This is in session three.
Okay.
We're talking about session four, culture, business culture. What else? Factors influencing the business culture. Okay. And the different types of symbols, the high level and low level symbols, and the difference between them. Quite okay? All right, very good. All right. So our last session today is the business ethics. Business ethics. When I say ethics, what comes to your mind? Ethics. Ethics. Adab? To be polite, you mean? To be polite, okay. In treating with, dealing with people, or what? In dealing with people?
Dealing with people, honesty.
In business.
Honesty, maybe.
Honesty, okay. All right. What else? What comes to your mind when I say ethics? Ethics. Honesty is one of the ethical issues, right? Ethics. How do ethics affect our lives? Do you think that we can live in an unethical society? How do ethics affect our lives? How they organize our lives? Without ethics, imagine living without ethics.
You can't.
You can't. Why? Imagine a society without ethics. I'm talking now about society level, not the business level. Society. Imagine a society without ethics. Ethics in dealing with each other. Ethics in conducting business. Ethics in looking after our children. Ethics in doing our jobs. Ethics in everything. Ethics in everything. Can we live without ethics?
No.
Okay, so let's see the aims and objectives of session five. Provide an understanding of what the study of business ethics involves. This is the first aim. The second aim is to outline why an understanding of ethics is so important for business people. Why should we understand ethics? As business people, why? You will know. Develop an appreciation of the different ways in which ethics relate to businesses. So ethics are related to business, some way or another. They are related. We'll see now. Okay. Explore some perspectives on the relationship between business and society. Explore some perspectives on the relationship between business and society. Okay, because normally the business has an ethical task towards the society. Okay, and we'll see now. Ethics. Tell me. You said honesty is one of the ethics. What else? Ethics. Tell me about different being honest, being polite, being what else? Give me examples of ethics. Go ahead.
Not cheating.
Avoiding plagiarism in team A's. This is part of the ethics, right? What else? Ethics. All right.
Following the rules.
I'm sorry?
Following the rules.
Following the rules. Here we will know something. Ethics, you mean by the rules, the law, right? Ethics are deeper than law. They are deeper than law. You know why? You don't know why. Okay. Assume that you told lies to one of your friends. You told him that, okay, tomorrow we don't have a class. Okay? Do you think that the law will penalize you for this?
No.
Do you think that it's ethical?
No.
It's unethical. Okay, so it's forbidden by ethics, but not by law.
Yeah.
You got that? So ethics are deeper. Deeper than the law. So when you care about ethics, this is more comprehensive. Okay? All right. So ethics, some characteristics here. We can go through the characteristics of ethics. Ethics are about values. Usually involve dilemmas such as dishonesty. Usually when we talk about ethics, ethics organizes a situation in which we have a problem. Should we be honest or dishonest? Okay? Okay, it's an issue on which we need to make a decision. All right. Presents choices between competing value based on principles. For example, the business would like to make profits. Okay? In order to make profits, they can reduce their costs by producing abroad, outsourcing. Like many of the multinational companies, they outsource it to India, to China, and so on. Why? Because of the less expensive labor there, right? Okay. Now, this will enable the company or the business to make profit, right? Better profit because of that, reduce the costs. All right. What do you think? Do you think that ethical or unethical? Why do I ask this question? Because outsourcing means that you fire the labor you have in your local country, and you send your manufacturing processes to be conducted abroad for the less expensive labor, which means that you affect your own society negatively, right? Okay, this is an unethical issue. Sorry, should we do that to gain profit? Or we should think of our society's interest. So it's a conflict. It's what we mean. Usually ethics handle, usually it includes, involves a question like that. Okay? It follows the widely accepted laws of society. Of course, ethics should be in compliance with law, although it is more comprehensive, okay, or wider, but it follows and comply with laws. It's very much denoted to morality and corporate social responsibility. Morality, like moral, when we talk about ethics, we talk about morality aspects, and corporate social responsibility of the business towards the society. Okay, it's more than obeying the laws. It's more than obeying the laws, as I give you an example now. Okay, it's the concern of all types of organizations, not only profit-seeking ones. Everybody should have ethics. For-profit organizations and non-for-profit organizations. All types of organizations should look for having ethics. Okay? So now we got a better understanding of what we mean by ethics, or not yet? To some extent? Okay. ethics will tell you what to do and what not to do. What is ethical and what is unethical. It gives you the map. Okay? Do that because, okay, there is no problem with this because this is ethical. Do not do that because this is unethical. Okay? Do not deceive the customer. For example, be honest with your customers. Okay? Do not put your employees under pressure by reducing their salaries or instability, giving them unstable contracts or whatever. All these things are related to ethics. What to do and what not to do. The code of ethics in any organization will tell the management and the employees there how to conduct the business ethically. Now we know the role of ethics in any organization. Do you think that ethics are important?
Yes, of course.
Very important. They organize everything. Okay, so here we have the definition. Business ethics can be described as the study of how we ought to conduct business, which means how we should conduct business. Okay, the study of what makes certain actions within the business context the right. What makes this action right? What makes this wrong? What makes this acceptable? What makes it unacceptable? Ethics, tell me about that. Okay? It often involves making choices between conflicting values. Should we outsource or produce locally? Conflicting values. Should we make use of the reduced costs or manufacturing expenses? Or we should look after our community and country interests? It's about more than obeying the law. We agreed on that. And it is the concern of all types of organization, not just profit-seeking private companies. Now you know what we mean by ethics? Everybody? Everybody know what we mean by ethics? Okay. Why is business ethics important? What do you think? Why ethics are important for any business? Go ahead, ethics. In any business, what is the role of ethics or code of ethics in any business? What is the role? No ideas? Nothing? Do you think that you can conduct a business without having ethics? How to deal with customers? Who will tell me about how to deal with customers? The code of ethics, right? Okay, what to do and what not to do? The code of ethics, right? Or how to deal with each other inside the organization as colleagues and the managers, ethics. So how to have a business without having ethics? Are they important or not? Okay, let's see. Businesses need to conform to the expectations of key stakeholders. Last time we covered this part of stakeholders. What do we mean by stakeholders? Stakeholders, who are they? Who are the stakeholders? Go ahead.
People have what? People affected or no?
All groups or parties that have interest in an organization. All groups or parties that have interest in an organization. And we gave examples on them. We said managers, employees, customers, suppliers, competitors, creditors. All these are stakeholders. The government, the community, everybody, yes?
The banks.
The banks are creditors, one form of the creditors. Okay? So business needs to conform to the expectations of key stakeholders. All the stakeholders expect very high level of ethics from businesses. We expect honest transactions. We expect you to be ethical in transactions with other entities, with suppliers, with customers, and so on. So ethics are important because they will put you on the right track and will enable you to conform with stakeholders' expectations. Okay? All right? So, customers expect you to be ethical. Suppliers expect you to be ethical. Owners expect you to be ethical. Right? Banks or creditors expect you to be ethical. So, having this code of ethics will enable you to conform with their expectations. If you do not conform with their expectations, what will happen? What's wrong with you? Go ahead. If you do not meet their expectations, what will happen? Huh? I'm talking about customers, owners. There's no business. Everybody's expecting something from you and you do not conform to what they expect. How long will you survive after that? Huh? You did not sleep. You are coming to sleep here in class. Okay, concentrate. All right, so you understand this first point? All right. Okay, the second point. Business depends on society, so it must respond to the needs of society. Now, okay, the business, in order to have a business and to conduct our transactions, we rely on society's resources, right? Where do we get resources from? Where do we get resources from?
Resources.
From where? From where? From where? From the society, right? The society provides any business with resources. And we covered last time the different types of resources, right? Okay, all resources that we use in any organization to do our business, tangible resources, human resources, intangible resources, are all from? The society somewhere or another. Some way or another, okay? And if you concentrate even on the natural environment, even on the raw materials and the natural environment, this is like a very clear example of what society provides us with, right? Okay, so because the society provides us with the resources necessary for conducting our business, we need to respond to the society positively. So do not pollute the environment, okay? Do not hurt people. Do not produce unhealthy products. Do not spread negative advertisements, and so on. Okay? So ethics will enable the business to respond positively to society's needs. Okay? Because you have a code that will tell you how to do that. All right. Business can only operate effectively if certain norms are respected. Okay. Now, do you think that you are the only business in the society?
No.
You have some other businesses? Okay. Like customers, suppliers, and so on? Right? All right. So, if you don't have ethics, okay, this means that you will deal with them unethically in some situations. Accordingly, they will do the same with to you in some other situations, right? So ethics protects you, not only you, it doesn't only protect others, but also protect you. Ethics does not only protect others, but also protect you as a business. Why? Because all businesses should have this code of ethics, and when they have this code of ethics, they will deal honestly with you. Okay, they'll provide you with good quality or high quality raw materials, for example. Okay, they will respect all the transactions and contracts that you have with them, and so on. Which means that ethics will benefit you as well as benefiting others. You got that? All right. So business exercises considerable power over the lives of people. Now, some giant businesses For example, Pepsi, Cola, huh? And what else?
Nike.
All the giant companies, when they have commercial, everybody watches this commercial, right? They have like a very wide customer base, right? So they should feel socially responsible. They should know that they play a very important role in the lives of people. When they have a commercial, this commercial should be in line with CAPEX. Okay? When they offer a product, this product should not hurt people because they have a very wide customer base. You need to know that you play a very important role in the citizens or in your customers' lives. So you have a social role. It's not only an economic role as a business. Okay? All right. The ethical code will enable the company to do that. The code of ethics will enable the company to do that. Have you ever seen any of the commercials that you feel that they have some negative impact on ethics? Unethical impact on people? Huh? Any of the commercials? Think of some, we have a lot. Huh? I know that you watch TV all the time. Go ahead. Huh? Some commercials that you feel that they were not suitable and they affected the people negatively, affected children negatively, and so on. Huh? Like what? Watch TV. This is another activity. Watch TV and bring me some of the commercials. A lot, but you don't have them in your mind now. Okay. So some of the commercials, listen to me. Some of the commercials teach children how to lie to their parents, not to do their homework, not to be organized in their lives, right? And so on. You will find a lot. So look for them and come next time with some commercials. Tell me that you feel that this company did not play its ethical, social role because this commercial does not conform with ethics. Okay? Tell me. All right. The last point, ethical behavior has intrinsic value. Here we talk about how people deal with each other in an organization. Code of ethics will tell people how to deal with each other. It will organize the relationship between employees and managers, between employees and their colleagues, okay? And so on. So we talk here about the internal environment of the organization. Ethics will organize such relationships. Because without having ethics, organizing such relationships, do you think that we'll have constructive work relationships inside the business? You know what I mean by constructive? No. Positive. Fruitful. Relationships. Assume that no ethics organize your relationship with your colleagues. Huh? Can you imagine it? They can go to your office, just turn your computer on, take whatever they would like to from your email, from your Outlook, from your computer, right? Right or wrong? Okay, right? Okay, talking to you aggressively, if you don't have code of ethics that organizes how to deal with each other, okay? And so on. All right. Well, in what ways do ethics relate to business? In what ways? Now we covered what we mean by ethics, the definition of ethics, and we covered why ethics are so important to a business. And now this is, in what ways do ethics related to businesses? Okay. Ethics is relevant to business at three different levels. The first level is the relationship between ethics and business at the macro level. This is the first thing. Relationship between business and ethics at the macro level. The second one, the relationship between ethics and the social and environmental impact of business. So between ethics and social and environmental impact. The first one is macro, the second one social and environmental impact. The third one is the relationship between business ethics and the personal conduct of business people. The personal conduct of business people. Okay, let's take them one by one. Okay. Here we talk about the macro level. When we talk about the macro level, it's about the governmental level. A macro level, society level. Okay. At the macro level, business ethics considers the overall framework within which business operates, the overall community, the overall society, okay, and so on. For example, should the government intervene in business activity in order to pursue certain social objectives or not? What is the role of the government in making, in ensuring that business follow ethics? Should they do that or not? This is a question. This is a question. Normally we have laws that organize the general, but as we said, ethics are wider than laws, as you know. So here we talk about the macro level, the relationship between the ethics and the business at a macro level, on the society level, the community level. How do you affect the community? How do you affect the society? And so on. This is the first relationship, okay? We need it to be positive relationship. Do not affect them negatively, okay? All right, so the second one is the relationship between ethics and the social and environmental impact of business. Social and environmental impact of business. Now, as the question I asked you about. Now, some giant companies outsourced their manufacturing processes, right? Okay, how did this affect the environmental and social aspects in the local country? Of course, you fired people and you hired others through outsourcing, right? You sent all the manufacturing processes abroad to China. So, which means that you raised the unemployment rate in your country. Right? Okay, this is one. So, this is an issue. This is a critical issue. Usually businesses, before making such decisions, ask themselves, what should we do? Is it ethical to do it or not? We should make profit. And we have a chance or an opportunity to make such a profit. Should we take this step or not? How does this step or this decision affect our social and environmental aspect? They usually ask this question, okay? All right, and some others like, should businesses, for example, should businesses promote employment in local communities or should they transfer production to cheaper overseas locations? This is the issue that I'm talking about now. Should businesses promote harmful products, for example, alcohol, to vulnerable groups such as children? This is the question. We care about making profits. Okay? Anybody who will come and ask me for taking this, I will sell the product. Should I do that? Or no? It's unethical. Okay. So such questions are involved under this chapter. All right. And here about the relationship between business ethics and the personal conduct of business people. How do you deal with colleagues? How do you deal with customers? How do you deal with managers? How do you deal with everybody else, with suppliers? This is about the personal conduct of business. So we started from the whole community level, then the social and environmental, only two aspects, social and environmental aspects level, and then the last level is the personal conduct, how we conduct our business ethically in terms of dealing with the parties that with which we have direct relationships, such as whom? Customers, suppliers, colleagues, employees, managers, and so on. All right? These are the three levels of ethical relationships. So when I ask you what, in what ways do ethics relate to business, you can say we have three different relationships: the macro level, the social and environmental level, and the personal conduct level. Do you have any questions about that, or it's clear? Okay, what are the responsibilities of business? This is the last point in this session. Responsibilities of business. When we classify, or when we discuss this issue, we classify responsibilities into four main levels. Four different perspectives. The first perspective is the responsibility of business to build shareholder value. Responsibility of business to build shareholder value. Who are the shareholders? What do you mean by shareholders?
The owners.
Excellent. Okay. The owners. So the first perspective is very tight. Okay? Our responsibility, our ethical responsibility, is to build a shareholder value. Shareholder value. We need to maximize their wealth. You know what you mean by shareholder value? Maximize their wealth, make profit, mainly in the short term. This is our ethical responsibility. Okay? This is the first perspective. So, the second one, the responsibility of business is to build long-term shareholder value. Long-term shareholder value. So the first one was to build a value. We do not care about building a long-term value. But the second one is about how to maximize the profit or the wealth of shareholders in the long term, to make sure that this will continue in the long term. So this is a wider perspective, perspective number two. So the first perspective, let's take them here. All right. Huh? Safe. The first perspective is what? Huh? The first perspective is what?
Shareholders.
No, shareholder does not mean anything to me. I'd like you to tell me about the ethical responsibility. Responsibility of business.
To build a shareholder value.
To build?
A shareholder value.
To build?
A shareholder value.
Shareholder value. The second responsibility, this is perspective number one. Okay? Which is very tight. The wider one is perspective number two. Huh? Is to do what?
Long-term shareholder value.
The responsibility of business to build long-term. Shareholder value. Okay. All right. The third perspective. Respects
the rights of
stakeholders. Okay. This is number three. And the last one.
To help the shareholders of society.
To help shape the society. This is the widest one. Help shape the society.
How?
A very important question. Okay, let's see. Now, the first perspective, our responsibility as a business is to maximize the shareholders' value. Okay? Nothing counts except making profits. This is the first responsibility. Do you agree with this? Or do you think that this is a very, this is a very tight scope? What do you think? Do you think that we have more other responsibilities?
Of course.
Okay. So the second perspective is to build long-term shareholder value. Long-term shareholder value. How to do that? How to build long-term, how to make sure that we will continue to be successful?
customer to make him happy.
Make customers happy. Excellent. Make employees happy.
Satisfied.
Right? So you should consider the other parties, but you consider them because you would like to maximize the shareholders' value, or because you believe that they deserve satisfaction.
Both.
In the second perspective, no, this one here. When you do that, you try to satisfy customers, employees, suppliers, and everybody, huh? Why? Because the overriding principle here is to maximize the shareholders' wealth in the long term. Not because you believe that they deserve that, but because you know that this is the only way. Okay? All right. But the third perspective, the third one, the responsibility of businesses to respect the rights of a range of stakeholders, you do that here, you feel responsible for a range of stakeholders. Who are the stakeholders? Customers, suppliers, employees, managers, government, community, creditors, all these people or these parties, you believe that they deserve satisfaction. You believe that it's part of their rights to respond to their desires, okay? So this is the difference between perspective two and perspective three. In perspective two, you try to satisfy them, but the overriding principle is this is the only way to maximize shareholders' wealth, okay? In perspective three, you believe that they deserve satisfaction, okay? So why? Because some employees stayed with you for many years. They refused job offers from other companies, right? And they are part of your knowledge base currently. So they deserve being promoted. They deserve good salaries, right? They deserve to respect their rights, to give them stability, right? The same for customers, your customers, to have long-term relationship with them because they are your source of income, not only source of income, but they like what you offer them in terms of quality, in terms of being on time, in terms of everything, okay? So why not respect their rights? So this is the third perspective. The last perspective is the responsibility of business is to help to shape the society. How to help shaping the society? How to help shaping the society? You have a responsibility towards the whole society as a business. This is the widest perspective. How to do your business, conduct your business within this perspective. Pay your taxation. Okay? Participate in community development programs. Right? Donate money if you can. Participate in developing different sectors in your country, and so on. So this is the widest perspective. This is the widest perspective to help shape the society, how to develop your society, okay? Like Pepsi. Pepsi, when they allocated, I don't remember the figure, it was like 10 millions, I don't remember, for education, for sports, you remember? You remember? Okay, so this way they were trying to help shaping the society, right? So this is the widest perspective that we would like other businesses to adopt. It will be wonderful then, right? To think of how to shape the whole society. This way everybody will do his role, his responsibility. Businesses will not hurt the society, will not hurt the environment, and so on. Right? Okay. So, do you have any questions? This way, this is the last point in our session today. So, do you have any questions? So, what did we cover in ethics, session five? What did we cover? Ethics. Why it is important, huh? Definition, we defined them first, huh? Why?
Responsibilities,
excellent. And how they relate?
To business.
How ethics relate to business, right? Okay, do you have any questions? Any questions? Okay. So I know this class was to some extent limited class, full of information. Sessions 3, 4, and 5. When you go home, study well. As I advise you every time, at least read today, even if you are not studying in detail, but at least read today so that you will not forget what we said, okay? Try to do the activities that I gave you. Watch for commercials that negatively affected the society, okay? And try to do, try to come next time prepared for class. Come, as I told you before, come active, do not come reactive, because reading before coming to class will help you a lot to gain a better understanding of the topic. Okay? All right? All right. Do you have any questions, any concerns?
No.
Okay. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
All right. Thank you.